Thank you for spending your Wednesday evening with me. This is AfroEconomics Live, and I'm J.D. Bryan, the President and Chief Investment Officer at J.B. Bryan Financial Group, the home of AfroEconomics and a registered investment advisory firm that I created in 1995 when I was real young, like real young. Unbelievable how young and starting that firm. But I appreciate the opportunity for us to have more than 25 years in business because of you. J.B. Bryan Financial Group is one of the first 100% registered investment advisory firms, 100% Black owned on the planet. So I'm excited that we're still here, we're still standing, we're still thriving because of your commitment to your financial success and your family's legacy. Without you, it wouldn't be possible. You and you and you, you too. Yes, indeed. How you doing, Ms. Jefferson? Rosita and the Hayeses and the Jenkins and Patricia and Ms. Jones and Ms. Johnson and Mr. March and Mr. Wynn. I'm going to tell you, look, two Larrys logged in right after each other. Yes, they did. That's amazing. And Latrice came in right as LL and L. A whole bunch of L right there. Indeed. Hi, Maurice. That's right. Bring it. Hopewell, Virginia in the house. Yes, I love it. I love it. I really, really appreciate you all tonight. I want us to interact. So I'm going to do my best. I'm going to open some of the mics for people that I know that know how to mute, and they will make sure that they're quiet, or I'm going to, even better yet. Hi, Christine. If you all say to me that you have something to say and you ask me, because I'm going to ask you a question, like, I want to know, how do you feel about the future of Social Security? Like, how do you feel about Social Security? Like, there's always people saying, you know, Social Security won't be around. Social Security's not going to be there. You know, it's going to end. It's going to, you know, but how specifically do you feel as a Black professional about the future of Social Security? I want to know your opinion. Anybody want to share their opinion? Put it in. Okay. It's Witherspoon. Says she's not hoping. My hope is not in Social Security. She wants to build her own riches. Anyone else? Uh-oh, Bello, do not depend on it. Okay. Who? Anyone else? Do not depend on it. That's Bello. I don't know. But it's Rosita said Social Security will be around. Oh, Miss Bello. Well, you really cut that off. I didn't even guess it. You agree with Miss Hayes. That's right. Miss Davis says, not sure it will be around, but it's my time to revive mine. Therefore, I need to make sure I have enough in my retirement. I know that's right. Let me show you. I'm going to show y'all something. Now, this one is, I'm going to try to get comfortable with government websites. So much information out there for us. And we just don't spend enough time there. But I also want to bring up, I was talking about the University of Pennsylvania, the study on Social Security. It came out May 28th, 2020. The impact of coronavirus pandemic on Social Security finances. You know, look at this. This is what their estimates are of the trust fund that is set up for Social Security to be depleted in 2035. Isn't that something? 2035. And then it says, this is what they're projecting. This is their Pennsylvania Wharton business model. That's what that PW BM stands for. That's their estimate from the school. And then look at this. If the V-shaped recovery for the pandemic will mean that if we just go down and we quickly recover, but if we, as far as economic growth, we're not talking about just the stock market now, because, you know, the stock market looks like, you know, a V, but you never know, it could end up being a W and an ugly one. So the, so look at the, so the U is when it comes back up, but it takes longer for wages and economic growth to happen. And they're saying if it takes longer for economic growth, then it will be depleted even faster. If the economy depletes quickly, then, you know, we might lose, you know, like it might run out about a year earlier. If it takes a longer time, then it will run out by, with the funds that it has in it now, they're estimating that it will run out in 2032. So definitely they have some work to do in Congress on getting that budget together. Indeed. Mr. Allison says, not counting on it with this payroll tax cut, you know what I mean? Talk, right? Ms. Davis was saying that she's going to make sure that she saves enough on her own. Mr. Travers says Social Security will be around for the next 20 years, but we should try to build our own dividend producing wealth. Indeed, some wealth that pays off or some asset that is creating income for you. And that is definitely what we do here. So I know that Social Security is designed for it to have money for everyone that's putting money into the system. So we know that even though changes have to be done, they will adjust for making sure that the person who puts money in either gets their money back out, because, you know, I would want to think that we're the ones that are voting for these people, that the least they could do is make sure that we get at least our money that we put in back out. And that, but look at the, even though there is, during this pandemic, there are reductions in money that's coming in, like Allison just made reference to, of reducing payroll tax revenues because there's not as many people getting paid. But a big portion of that those payroll loans, those paycheck protection loans that they gave out are, you know, most likely if people want to not have to pay them back, they're going to put it back into the system via tax revenues to the government from the loans that were given to make sure that people were getting their paycheck. So we'll see how that works out. But that was the point, that the government knew that we could kind of let them slide on this loan if the overwhelming majority of this money is spent on making sure that people can pay their bills and the taxes are paid on that. The wages that we're giving them the loan to pay the payroll, look at how much of your check goes back to the government. Think about it. So that's how they can loan the money to keep the businesses going and keep them off unemployment, right? I said, let's give them this, keep people working. So they have less money coming in, but then you also have, you know, some money coming in, and then people are getting back to work, just not at what pace is the question. But there's also the reduction in the cost of things. Because see, look at this. You can see this. But coronavirus increases mortality rates, which, the mortality rates, meaning the people are dying because of the virus, and it's skewed towards people that are getting Social Security. So the if God forbid, the coronavirus picks up and more people on Social Security die off, like say like the overwhelming majority of people that die are collecting Social Security, that only helps Social Security because they have a reduction in costs. And then they also have, you know, a slowing in inflation. The cost of things they're saying is going down, even though us as private citizens, to me, it looks like the cost of things have gone up during COVID. I mean, tell me one thing that's gotten cheaper. Woo. Allison said, I've often wondered if it was a strategy to let people die. That's interesting. Oh, gases, but we're not going anywhere. So, you know, gas, and that's what happens when they say that Social Security income increases are based on cost of living adjustments. And then when the gas goes down, they will reduce what the check, the cost of living adjustments on Social Security checks, paychecks, you know. And so, but the cost of things for seniors are actually getting higher. Are you with me on this? Like that they're having to pay more for health insurance, higher deductibles, you know, cost them more for home improvements, you know. So I believe, in my opinion, that we should have two inflation rates. You should have the average person's cost of living and you adjust that. Okay, maybe for the average person, we do get the benefit of lower gas prices, but the senior citizens don't have to commute every day. They don't have to do all that driving as we have to do. So their inflation rate should not be pulled down by, say, cheaper fuel prices because of lack of demand. You know, they shouldn't, they're, because the cost of the things that they're buying is going up dramatically higher. But when you put them all together, that's what that COLA, cost of living adjustment, is based on. Everything thrown in the same bucket. So if I say there should be a senior cost of living, meaning that what percentage of a senior's income is spent on these particular items and allow their cost of living adjustment to be determined, weighted on what is important in their specific bucket, right? And then, yeah, all these things, exactly, Ms. Bullock, wipes, sanitizers, you know, all this stuff has gone up because of what we're going through. Seems to me like so many more things we can easily think of have got food prices are higher, all of that. And then they're saying that the cost of living is lower, interest rates are lower. All that really impacts seniors because they're not trying to take a lot of risk with their investments, but they still need their money to grow. So it becomes even more challenging on how to protect their assets, but also keep pace with inflation. And those of you who didn't get to see it, I recorded and it aired this morning about this very topic with CBS, and I was explaining to them about the average wage index factor that is used to multiply out what your actual benefit will be for Social Security. So if the average wage index factor is pulled down dramatically because of all these wages going down this year, because, you know, a lot of people are getting zero wages, they lost their job, millions. Well, for this, because of how Social Security is calculated, the person turning 60 this year gets the major impact on their income. And in the for that Pennsylvania Wharton study, they're saying they're estimating 13% reduction in the Social Security benefit for a person turning 60 this year because of wages going down so much. But I also saw in the Congressional Budget Office is estimating 9%. And the only way out of it is going to have to be for Congress to say, let's change how we calculate the Social Security benefit. Because for this year, if we do that wage index, this particular people turning 60 this year are going to be hit, you know, harder, and it will impact them going forward. So the Social Security, Ms. Bullock's question was, are Social Security wages going down? In a way, they are going to go down because the cost of living adjustment is anticipated to be zero for this year. So for a person who's currently on Social Security, they will feel like their check has gone down because the cost of things is actually going up for them. But even though the government is going to tell you, no, the cost of things have overall gone down, because the things that they put in there that have gone down so dramatically, you know, that it pulls down the things that actually have gone up that we use the most. So I feel that it needs to be weighted based on use, not just calculating everything and it canceled so many things that aren't even needed anymore. You know, so the cost of things that aren't even needed are going down, but yet they're pulling down your inflation rate and you're using that to determine my income adjustment, you know? But I think that we've been told so much and instructed so much and we accept so much that we don't think that we have an option, but we do have an option. We do have a right to complain. I think that we do have a requirement, really, to voice out more and to get a better understanding. And then we need to have more people on our team who understand Social Security and money on this level. I have yet to hear anybody in Congress talk about this study. Like, they're going through, you know, everything in the world, talking about everything except for real life issues that people, you know, that are going to be impacted by this. They need to be discussing right now, are we going to allow the people turning 60 in 2020 to, for their Social Security to be locked in at, you know, 13% or 15% or 10%, what, lower than it should be just because of COVID and the government's decision, a requirement really, to close down businesses. So let me show you something. And I don't think that we think about this enough. I just have to get it set up for you. I want to show you this. When to start retirement benefits. Now, ask me any questions if you have any question about what I'm saying. Bottom line, on what we just talked about is that, and I should, let me do that. Let me do that first. I'm going to do that. Okay. Key questions here. This is the point. This is the take home. The Congressional Budget Office projects that Social Security benefits will be hurt by COVID-19. According to that Congressional Budget Office, that people who turn 60 in this year will be permanently reduced. Their benefit will be permanently reduced by 9%. But I'm saying is that the academic study is saying most likely closer to 13%. So how did this come about? Well, Social Security benefits are based on your 35 highest years of earnings. Your 35 highest years of earnings. Then you take that, and they don't have to be consecutive. You could have made nothing, and then the next year you make a whole bunch, and then a whole bunch, and then a little, a lot. And they only take your highest 35. And then that is indexed and then basically kind of multiplied by the growth of the average wages until the year that you reach age 60. So the age of 60 basically is like when you max out on your 35 years. So you work as long, make as much as you want, you know, for that. And then it's indexed on that. But I do know that even if you work longer, I guess then the adjustments are just based on their adjustments to it, to the Social Security's adjustments. So that index is taken over by the Social Security Administration and their adjustments in the factor or the amount that is determined at that age of 60. So with you turning, if a person is turning 60 this year, that index based on average wages is anticipated or expected to be pulled down dramatically, impacting their income, you know, and on average, that could be as much as $2,500 a year for the rest of their life. And that it could be, you know, and basically it could be worse the next year because that's probably the hardest part for them to say. Like if they take the index out, and for some reason, 2021, that, you know, everything, the wages are even worse, then, you know, what do they do then? If they say, well, we're going to take it out as a factor for, and you're already running out of money. So I think at some point that it has to be said that this is the way it's always been. This is the way it's always done. We will continue to do it this way. And it's not going to always work out for everybody. Like there's people who retired, you know, right at like say 2007, 2008, you know, and never anticipated, you know, that the market would take so long for them to recover their money. And they might have been terrified and took everything out and, you know, lost. I mean, a lot of people lost a lot of money. They didn't have any advisors. They didn't know who to talk to. They didn't have, you know, I've had so many clients tell me that even if you go back as far as like 9/11, they were like, if I didn't have you to talk to, I don't know what I would have done. You know, I believe even research is showing. They did research on asked surveys and they asked people, would you prefer what is called a robo-advisor or would you prefer to have a human advisor? And the overwhelming majority of people said they would prefer to have a human advisor to assist them. So with this being that the people who turn 60 this year will feel like, why is this happening to me? We can look back through time and there's always going to be where people are going to feel, why is this happening to me? Like there's just always, you know, a person could retire and get the best, you know, wage index and then die in a year, you know, and their Social Security goes all back to the system and they only got to enjoy, you know, or maybe didn't even start yet. So, you know, we have to make the best out of every situation. So that's why we do this. That's why it's powerful what you're doing with your time. You can be watching anything. You don't have to be like, you know, actually doing this for yourself. So what If your person is going to lose approximately with something they never even had set, you know, never had, but just say it's, you know, $2,500, because they might not even know. Now I'm trying to, as you get closer and closer to retirement and that becomes like our biggest issue, I try to get you to get the estimates and we put that into our secure portal. And then it, you know, allows us to kind of see from year to year, like, because there's one person that we're working on their numbers, and they, it was interesting because they called Social Security, and they gave her a figure that was less than the printout. So when we called back, I said, schedule another appointment. I want to ask them why your numbers are off like this. Why did they say that amount? You know, but your paper says this amount and it's a year, you're a year older than what this is saying. Like say she said 62 and now you're 63 and they're telling you even less than that. Like, so then when we talked the next time and, you know, she kind of told them like my paper says, and then they said, oh yeah, your amount is blah, 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 blah. You know, and I was wondering like, what in the world it would have said if she had not said anything. Like, that's spooky to me. Like the, but she kind of gave it to them. I would have said, what is the amount? You know, just to see, make sure that they have it in the system. Because then when I'm telling you what the number should be, and you're saying, yeah, that's what the number should be, but yet, you know what I mean? You didn't say that that's, you're the one that calculates the number. Like, I want something. You know, so we ask them to send something in writing, you know, but this is, you know, spooky times, some spooky times, a lot of people working a lot of different places, and you don't know how coordinated their network is. So, you know, just get as much as you can. When it got into another issue, because they're sending the client money out of her account, you know, and she didn't ask for the money out of her account. And she specifically said, I don't want any money out of my account next month. So when she got the money out of the account, you know, she said, could you call them for me? And, you know, and you don't have to be nice this time, because, you know, sometimes I just like don't want to be nice to shoes. Like, and I've been trying to be nice, but I don't, you know what I mean? It just makes no sense to me. When you cannot tell me why you did, you know, why they did what they did. So the, you know, all they could say was, you know, oh, well, the two systems and one system did this, and this hasn't happened before and blah, blah. And I said, you know what, could you send that to the client in writing? And I think that that has to be a commitment to us, you know, as a people. I remember when I worked in corporate America, like, that would be one thing that if I started, like, writing down, like, my manager would, like, be so irritated. He'd go, well, what are you writing? What are you writing? And I was like, I'm writing down what you said. Like, they would be so irritated that you're recording and that you're writing. But that is the power of, we need to get more things in writing. Because just saying that, and then they will hang up on you. You know what I'm saying? Before, so it's like now I have to ask, what is, you know, what's your name going into the conversation? You know, because have you noticed that when you call places, they don't go, hi, this is, you know, Michaela, blah, 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 blah. No. Hi, thank you for calling, blah, blah, blah. You know, and they don't. So you got to like slow it down, get the control, and then, you know, and ask. And I think Einstein said this, like, you don't have to know all, and the person that you want to be with is not the person that knows all the answers, but the person who knows the questions. And that's why it's so powerful for me to assist you. Because I don't know the answer, but I'm able to help you find out what you need to know, because I know the question. I know the question. And that's how we have to become obsessed with the question. And whoever does not want to address your question, you cannot deal with them. And repeatedly, You know, I see clients dealing with people who have no care for them, none at all. I just don't think that, you know, we really have to stop tolerating the lowest of the level, of the lowest in service. You know, once, what is it Maya Angelou said? Once somebody shows you who they are, believe them and keep it moving. Full armor. You know, if somebody doesn't want to talk to me so that I can help you, you know you're dealing with the wrong person. So this is real. So this is, say you turn, and this is from Social Security, SSA.gov. Say you turn 62 in 2020, and they're saying that your estimate, your payment would be $716. You're like, I hope not, right? So 62 this year, full retirement age is right here at 66 and 8 months. So they could choose to take it, but if you know your full retirement benefit is this $1,000, you're losing like 30% by starting early. What would be a key reason to start early? Look, it says if you start at 62, you'll reduce your monthly benefit by what? It's actually 28.4. I was saying like almost 30%. And the decrease is usually permanent. Why would somebody consider starting at exactly, Sheree, indeed. I talked to you today. It's different to see last, yeah, exactly. The definitely health problems, a key reason, because they're feeling like, well, first of all, and then what would be a second reason? A second reason to take it at 62. Health problems, a good one. Another key reason to take it at 62. I know everybody's thinking it, just not saying it because you're like, it's too obvious, but because you need the money, you know, it's like, if you have bills and you can't pay your bills, you know what I mean? And you're 62, that's right. It's not making enough money. You need the money. But if you're 62 and you have a job and you, like this year, it's about 18,000 is the maximum income that you can make, you know, and not get the Social Security counted against you. So that's the bad thing, is that you can't really even make that much W-2 income. But that might be the advantage of you starting your own business, because at least if you start your own business and you make $25,000 in sales, you can reduce your, you can write off your expenses associated with creating that income. And you might have expenses of 10,000. So your income would only be 15, right? So the, you know, definitely, you don't even realize it, that the older you get, that it becomes, it could be even more beneficial of why it's important to have an understanding of having your own business and the Schedule C and how to control your taxable income and everything, what it means. So then each year, the closer you get to your full retirement benefit, and then after your full benefit, what happens? After that full benefit, that's right. Ms. Witherspoon said she's going to keep on working towards becoming a billionaire, because when I'm ready to retire, I'm ready to retire. I want to be traveling the world at 102 instead of worrying about if my kids or great kid, grandkids gonna look out for me because my Social Security ain't cutting it. I know that's right. Indeed. That indeed. So keep the health and the money right. I believe that if we keep our money right, the health will be better because, you know, a lot of the stress, you know, is, you know, can do some damage to your health big time, right? So every year after you're full, you're getting this, what? You're getting that bonus. You're getting that bonus. You're getting an 8% jump. Boom, boom, boom. So if they want to get a guaranteed return on their money, you know, like if I have a client that is still working and like just to say, even if they had their own business or something and they don't have a pension plan in the business, they can use their Social Security as their pension plan. So they're taking the, you know, they're putting off the Social Security, living off their business, you know, at seven till 70. And then at 70, they're forcing them to start taking the money. They have to. Now, one way for Social Security to get out around that problem of running out of money is to bring this age up. Because I know a lot of people, especially a lot of white people, who don't want their money at 70 years old. You know, and I remember my first, this lady I bought a building from, and I remember one day I was like, how you doing? We were like checking in with each other and everything. And she says, girl, can you believe they are making me get that check? I do not want to be getting that Social Security. I don't even need it. Blah, 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 you know. And she was single. I don't think she ever had children. You know, but if your income exceeds a certain amount, your Social Security income can be taxed up to 85%. So you have different for married, filing jointly, and for single, you know, it's like around $25,000. You know, that it's not, doesn't have to be that high before you begin to start being taxed on your Social Security, but the maximum is 85% of it can be taxed. Another way for them to raise money will be that they'll increase the taxation, the tax, that like they might bring that to like 90 or 95% of Social Security can be taxed in order to, you know, get their money in. So Twyla said, what about folks like me? That's right, who paid into the system and then paid into the other system and received, you know, but you have the military benefits, but cannot receive Social Security. Wow, right? And but it's kind of like you're receiving it early. Think of it like that. You know, because you were worked, the benefit comes from the federal government. They won't let you double dip into the federal government. And that's the only thing. It's like, but, and you know, they're like, that's my money. So I'm already giving you my money. So you can't get that money because that's my money. You know, that would be my money too. So you get this, but over your lifetime, you will come out ahead as long, Twyla, as you live a long life. Because like even if a person starts their Social Security at 62 and they live, you know, a really long time, you know what I'm saying? Like they could catch up with a person that waited, you know, because they could have that event. But typically, if the person is starting earlier, it might be because of some health issue or, you know, something. So, you know, they don't tend to like live to 100 years old, but it is possible. And they, you know, they might actually come out ahead than the person, even though the other person's checks will be bigger, but they would have started 8 years sooner, eight times what they were getting a month. I mean, for the whole year. And then depending on what they did with it can really make a difference, right? Ms. Bullock says, if you work private industry and government, you can double dip. So the you really wouldn't be double dipping. You know why? You know why? You know why you wouldn't be double dipping? I'm just kidding. If you work private industry and you work in the government, like, you know, why would it not be double dipping? Oh, look at you, Akilah. I see y'all. I'm trying to open up some microphones. I guess I could have warned y'all. Who's gonna talk to me?
Hello.
How you doing?
Hello.
Why would if a person worked in private industry and they worked for the federal government, why would it not? How could it not be considered double dipping?
I don't know about the private industry part.
Like it, yeah, because like, what? Anybody else want to say anything? I know, because you are all in federal.
I just know federal. If that's you're right. Under civil service,
that's right.
You'll be double dipping, and they take 2/3 of your Social Security. If you
what
also
if a person was a what, new, if a, what if a, what if a person was SERS, and they had a part-time job, somewhere else. They could get Social Security also.
Yeah, once they get that 40 quarters.
That's right.
They could, but usually most of the time they'll be wasting their time getting another job. Because yeah. It really doesn't add up to be anything.
So that you feel like a lot of times it's worked out that because of not being able doing that. They really didn't make that much money at the other job. That's kind of what you're saying.
Right, right.
But like, just say they got like $500. Their Social Security would be dramatically smaller. Their SERS check might be $3,000. Their Social Security might be $500, $600. But they're not double dipping because the employer, when you work in private industry, they have to put that money in too. So the government gets money from you when you work somewhere other than the government. They get money from your employer to put money away for you. So you're putting away 77.5. The employer puts away 7.5% of what you're making. So you definitely aren't double dipping. It's just that you've put, you know what I mean, extra money away over there. And it feels like it because you're like, how they get two checks, but it's only because they created a different pot. Does that make sense, Cynthia? Y'all get it? Look at y'all, like all y'all just muted out all of these names. I see all y'all names. I didn't even open up everybody. But I see y'all. Y'all just gonna be quiet? But any questions about Social Security?
JB, I wanna know, by me being a FERS, and I started in the federal, they stopped the civil service and we became FERS, Federal Employment Retirement System. And part of our retirement is a pension, our TSP, and Social Security, because they reduced the pension and made us put into our retirement. As for instead of the civil service, they gave them money.
That's
to
right.
Retire on.
That's
so
right.
How does my Social Security, how is it going to be affected now that it's part of my retirement?
So when you are a FERS, you're saying your Social Security is part of
my retirement
of your check. Exactly. And then how will these things change? Well, I don't think that because you don't see us, let me know, do you get a specific Social Security check or you get one check from the federal?
We get Social Security supplement, they added in with our pension.
And they, you can see that on there.
Yes. It's a separate amount, but we, you know, as a whole, it's in with our pension. Yeah.
Wow. So that's a very good point, because if they don't do a cost of living adjustment, then you're not going to get the cost of living adjustment. You know what I mean? But the federal government decides on the cost of living adjustment. You know what I'm saying? For your pension and for your Social Security.
Well, I don't get it until I'm 62 anyway. So the cost of living, we don't get it unless you're 62.
Anyway, so Right. Say you were and you were getting it, you know what I'm saying? Then, and they had like that year, they said no cost of living adjustment, you know, then you wouldn't, if the Social Security didn't, but the federal said it was. But most likely, if federal is the ones that decide what the cost of living, what the COLA number is, they'll call it. So they use it for their pension, they use it for salaries. They use it in, you know, and industry, private industry uses what the federal government says the cost of living adjustment is also. So it's, you know, that's a very, very good point. But the best thing about when they switch from FERS to CERS, it was most likely not to the benefit of a person who was a CERS to switch to a FERS. Unless they really knew what they were doing with the TSP, and most people didn't. So with the FERS, when people came in, the match on the FERS is very nice. The TSP is a, you know, I mean, it's a competitive retirement fund. You don't have a lot of options. But I help people take advantage of the TSP all the time. So if you take it seriously, your TSP contributions can totally outperform what that pension growth would have been. But most people, especially federal government people, they take the TSP for granted. And even when a person is a FERS, they kind of think of themselves as a CERS. And then when they find out the pension ain't really that big, you know, it's like you said, like that they're shocked, but it's, they're depending on, they're matching, you know, and most people don't even participate up to the level of the government match in the TSP. But if they maximize their contributions, got those government matches, took advantage of their agency. Many agencies have their own match, and then made sure the allocation was correct for where they were in their life. Talk to an advisor that they could do way better, because you can, you know, create income from your investments, and it gives you a lot more flexibility than a pension does. But you have to have, you know, a huge amount of discipline, and you have to have an opportunity to meet someone like me way early in the career. Because most of the time I meet people and they've been there 30 years, been there 25 years, they've been there, you know, so, but the earlier we start on this thing, Ms. Hill, a young lady called me today and she was like, I met you. You came to speak in my college class, you know? And I was like, wow, you know, that the earlier she gets started on that, right? The more effective that it'll be. We shouldn't really, you know, be as fascinated with pensions as we are, you know, but because if you saw, like, you know, the pensions are like the Social Security, you know, that you don't have any control over it, and you can't get to the lump sum, and you don't know how much money that is, and they're working for you, you know. And then upon your death, like, you know, with Social Security, like it's gone. And if you're married, they only get the larger of the two. So isn't that sad? Like, you really have to, you know, realize that if you had, if 15% of your income was grabbed from you and you had to invest it. Do you realize how much better off you would be than this little bit of money they're talking about with Social Security? No, that's how much money goes away into that Social Security. 7.5 from you and 7.5 from your employer. That's 15% of your income from day one going into that bucket. And you can't choose how to invest it. It's something to think about, right? Something to think about. Okay, everybody.
I have a question as far as like what should be, so what, for somebody that leaves their job at a young age and goes into entrepreneurship, I don't really quite understand all of like Social Security and how that works when you're an entrepreneur, but what should your considerations be? Like, I don't intend to ever go back and work for somebody else from 9 to 5.
That's right.
I mean, I may get paid as a contractor or like through that means, but what, like, what should I know about Social Security as a younger entrepreneur?
It's done for you. Like, you have to make a commitment to what your salary is going to be, you know, and then if not, you'll never do it. You say, well, I'm going to make sure that I make at least, you know, what amount of money, you know, each month or each quarter or every 6 months, whatever it is, you need to do payroll taxes. And the payroll taxes will take out your Medicare, your Social Security, your state, your federal, you know, it will take care of that for you. When you set up with your payroll company, we got Larry March, we have members. You know what I'm saying? He has a whole team and they work with businesses on, you know, setting that up. You know, there's, you know, a whole bunch of stuff that can help you set up if you want to work it on your own. You know, we can, you know, all the time. So with the entrepreneurship membership, you know, I encourage entrepreneurs to have a really good understanding. So I help you set up things for yourself. So even when you're working with your tax professional, you know what is going on. You know, we cannot allow these things to happen and we don't understand what's going on. There's, you know, when you're a business owner, that's what makes it so amazing. You have to know how to do everything. Fix the toilet. Call the customer, follow up, keep the database, set up the website, do the payroll, print out the balance sheet. You know what I'm saying? You have to, and then after you know how to do it, then you get some, pay someone else to do it. But you don't pay someone else to do it and then go, I don't know what I got. You know what I'm saying? We have to understand everything. Yes, indeed. Mr. March just said, I'm here. You should project your income to estimate your future benefit, and you will still pay into Social Security. That's right. He said you can project your income so that you can know, you know, about how much at this income, about how much will my Social Security be at blah, blah, blah age. And you already have some years in there, so they might already, so you know, if I continue to do at least what I have done, you know, then I'll do this. But when you leave corporate America, you don't want it to stop, especially for a young person that hasn't been working that long. Like, I started my business, you know, so early. So I had to make sure that I was participating. I even pay unemployment insurance, you know? So that all of that stuff, like, you don't, there's things that you don't have to do, you know, when you have a smaller firm, but you know, you should do it. I hate when people, like, I have a client was telling me today, and she went to get some paperwork done at the courthouse, and they said, well, you don't really need that. And it's almost like you can't really even trust it when somebody says you don't really need that, because you have to go, well, what if I do? Or under what I tell you, like, it's all about the question, knowing which question we need to ask these people. Because they are not going to. Why is it that everything has to be given to us only on a need to know basis?
Right.
Does that irritate you too? You know what I'm saying? Like, but then, and then how? What gives you the right to decide when I need to know it. Mm. And then Mr. March was saying, as a CPA, he does tax planning and CFO services for small business owners. And Twyla says, but his retirement, he's going to work. Oh, that's where you, I think you and Mr. Travers, y'all are having a discussion about her husband. But definitely make sure that we talk. Indeed. Yes, indeed. I'm like reading it. They just talk, and that is so good. Indeed, Miss Hayes. Indeed. Oh, and Mr. March. Indeed, right? Indeed. It is so good. It is so good. And it's amazing to me, like, the opportunities. Like, I appreciate someone like Mr. March because it's the opportunities that someone like me who's helping analyzing the return and finding the challenge to have someone to say, okay, look at this. You know what I mean? And then let's get what can we do about this and get that straight? Because, that everything has to be a team. Everything has to be a team. And I think that we live in a society that tries to program us to make us think that one thing is more important than another thing. So because this job is the most important. I mean, like, try to, go in the hospital and do whatever your family member something has to do in the hospital without having everybody in the hospital, down to the person that brings the food to the patient. Who is actually most important? Like, everybody has to be working together, because when the people in the cafeteria aren't working together and the patient dies because they never got their food, you hear me? Whose job actually becomes important? So that it's the everything, like, we have to, like, make a commitment to acknowledging that everything contributes to the full picture of our lives. Everything, our overall discipline as a person. That's why I'm working on this, on something I'm gonna tell y'all about on Friday during our members only meeting. But I believe that, through COVID, I want us to start taking advantage of why it's important for us to be disciplined, during COVID, and to refocus, and how much more powerful it's going to bring us out, financially and spiritually, and intellectually, for everyone that's looking at us and depending on us. We gotta power up. We gotta strengthen up. We can't fold. Like, there's, we don't have those type of options. There's too many young people depending on us to grow through this. This is not a time for us to be going out and buying cars and, worrying about material items and, which cruise we're going to go on next, and are they still going to have cruise lines and things like that. This is time for us to be thinking about your legacy, and if I pass today, what's going to happen? Or is my paperwork in order? How is this COVID going to impact my retirement, my Social Security? How is my health? Am I walking every day? We need to have some serious, serious regathering of our priorities, right?
I mean, I do need a car, but but I get you.
That's right. I ain't mad at you. But that could be argued differently, because I know that you live in an urban area. So there's a difference between need and want. You might want a car, but you don't need a car.
Actually, my car was stolen, and now I need to replace it. It was stolen like a couple of weeks ago, and
you might not even need to replace it, depending on what your options are with that money, because they've got to pay you the money. You know what I'm saying? And you can say, well, I don't even need a car right now. I'm not going anywhere. I'm working from home. I can get Uber as needed. Give me the check and let me catch bills up, or let me, you know, whatever. Let me just have an emergency fund for a second, you know, I think that that's just an example of how society has told us what a need is. And a lot of times the need is actually a want. True?
No, it is. Usually it is. I didn't
not
know
just for- you, but just in general. Like, a lot of times we think a need is, but it's not a need. You know what I mean? What do we truly need? Air, you know, food, substance, you know, God, shelter. Prayer. You know, what do we really need? Like, need. Yeah. We need an opportunity to create income. We need health. But need.
That's true. I think the corona, this like whole pandemic has shown like what's important. So like food, shelter, community, like
having the, what they need for the little ones back there. You know what I'm saying? Like making sure they got the tools they need. Exactly. And the businesses. Sometimes like this is an opportunity. You know, a lot of people have money flowing through their hands and they're not investing in their businesses like they should. You know, they should be, you know, or investing in their education or investing in their skill. A lot of people have time. Like, you know, they should be taking classes. They should be learning a new craft. They should be creating, helping somebody, creating a YouTube channel, you know, putting up videos every day, like, you know, help somebody. That's needed. That's seriously need. Like, it is like a need in your life to help somebody every day. If not for that, like, I don't understand, like, really, like, what we're here for. A lot of it's like, just, we think we're here because we're supposed to, like, buy things and look good and, you know, that. Well, we look a lot better when we're living, you know, out a purpose and a service, you know, because it just doesn't stop. Your life won't stop. You're helping somebody, you know what I mean? Your life will never stop. You will live in me. You help me, you will live in me. It's true. So y'all have a great night.
You too.
Something to think about, but the we're gonna follow this Social Security stuff closely, right? We're gonna see what's up, see what's going on. If you hear about something, let me know. Let me see what we got. Some yes and yes and true and true and an amen. Thank you. I don't know what happened, like Twyla, like why I don't know why your phone won't let me come in. Look at that. Mr. Robinson down there. Look at that. All my friends down there. Oh, look at y'all. What am I gonna do? If I pull the phone up, the least you can do is say hi. Somebody say hi. I'm opening up these lines. Rosita, you're being quiet too.
Hello.
Hello.
Good evening, JB.
I can't see who that is. Who is that?
That's Benita that said good evening, JB.
Bonita. There you go. I see your name now.
Hello.
Well, Allison said hello.
And Allison said hello. Hey, Allison.
And Cynthia said hello.
I know Allison is an AKA. One of her sorors is running for vice president.
Woohoo!
Anybody else at AKA? My sister is. She's usually on here. Sharona is. My dad was an alpha.
Hello, good night.
With Mr. Travers.
Hello.
Who is that? Who is that? Look at that. Y'all see Miss Woodson on the horse? Look at that. Y'all are so classy. You know, a lot of y'all, like, I'm trying to, like, hit.
Yeah.
Oh, is that you, Mr. Randolph?
Yeah. Good night.
Good to hear your voice. Good night.
Oh, you can hear me. Good.
Yeah. I need to see y'all soon. Nobody has their camera on. I don't know what's up.
How was you saying
someone, Patricia, your mic is open. I can't believe it. Say something, Patricia. Patricia, I can believe it. She's being quiet because she is shy. She is shy for real. Well, it's so good to hear y'all voice. Y'all are not, but the overwhelming majority of you all are not shy people. Why you don't have videos on, I do not know.
Videos for the young lady.
Videos
for the young lady.
Videos for the young ladies, exact. No.
There you go.
Look, I hit this button called turn off non-video participants. All of y'all went blank. Goodness gracious. now you just see me. Exactly. It was good to see y'all pictures. Did you enjoy that, Mr. Randolph, Mr. Joe?
Yes.
It was good discussion. Yes. Yeah. That's
yes. Oh yes. Oh yes.
Well,
we'll see.
You know, I'm gonna continue to follow this because everything is just a projection right now. But let's see how it turns out. And I look forward to all of us getting together soon. I just don't know if I should encourage you to come out of the house, you know? I'm not quite comfortable with that. I haven't had a meeting since March.
I got you.
You know, I really have not had a meeting since March. No, not a face-to-face. It's been all
Yeah.
The text will work.
Yes, indeed, right? Or do the Zoom.
Yes.
How you doing, Miss
Grant? We're still getting information.
Exactly. Indeed. Well, have a great night, y'all. And
please consider
hanging out on Friday morning. It's especially those of you who are retired.
All right.
You have no excuse.
All right.
Good night.
Good night, y'all. Good night, everyone. Have a good one.
You too.
Thank you. All so kind.
All right.
Good night.
Good night.
Man, so good. Have a good night. Trying to swallow. I wish you could see what I see, Twyla. It says that thing about the older version. I'm gonna promote you, show you what it does. I'm gonna watch this.